health practical settings are all made by old white men. Hi everyone, what is up? My name is Haley. Welcome to my YouTube channel. If you do not know, now you do. Hey you guys, what's up? In today's video, y'all, surprise, surprise, you can already tell from title and thumbnail who I'm talking about today. I'm gonna be talking about the SPD. I know a lot of people do not like these political videos. That is perfectly fine. The end of this week, they will be done. I'll go back to my normal content, but until then, we're gonna keep going on. So today, you guys, we're talking about the Social Democratic Partei in Germany. The Social Democrats, I think, in English language is the best way to translate it. Like I said in my other videos, the meaning of conservative, liberal, social, non-social is very different in the United States. So the placement for these parties for me are usually different than what they are placed on in Germany. I consider the SPD to be more left-ish, but when I read things comparing it to the CDU, I do think it's a little more left than the CDU is. It is one of the biggest in the sense of like majority of votes, and it is also one of the oldest parties in Germany. I think it is the oldest party that is like still active to this day. It was formed in 1863, I believe, and it is considered or was considered a Marxist party. But then later on, coming into the 60s, I think, or the end of the 50s, they changed it and they just considered themselves a Social Democrat Party. An interesting fact that I found when reading about the party was that in 1933, they were the only party to vote against the Enabling Act, which is one of the ways that Hitler came into power. And I just thought that was interesting that they were there right in the thick of everything happening and they voted against it, which is good. It was an interesting fact that I learned, didn't know that beforehand. They have mostly been in cahoots with the CDU, CSU, and the FPD, you guys, I know it's not that, but more so the CDU and CSU than the FDP. The face of the SPD is Olaf Scholz. He is the Vice Chancellor of Germany currently, and this is also something that I did not know. Did Angela Merkel nominate him, or was he nominated because he was like the second biggest party? Because in the United States, usually like the president that gets elected gets to choose his vice president, or like they usually choose them ahead of time and then you know who you're voting for. And so I don't know if it's the same in Germany, but he is the vice chancellor currently. He is the minister of finance, which I also found to be very interesting. He's like a lot of things. He has his hand in a lot of things, and he was also the minister of labor and social affairs, but no longer is. He studied law and was a lawyer that specialized in employment and labor, I believe. And regarding his political career, when you're putting it up against all the other candidates that I will be talking about and have talked about in the past, he is probably the one with the longest resume, because he has been around, I think, since the early 1900s, not the early 1900s, the early 1990s, maybe even into the 80s. So he's been in politics probably as long as I have been alive, and maybe even a little longer than that. So there's not really much to go over. He's done everything. He's almost hit like the top level of being chancellor. He's vice chancellor, so I feel like he has a lot of experience. Like I said, do I think politicians only having political experience or having a lot of political experience is the best thing? No, but I think it's important. So I'm gonna start off with a positive aspect of him and then go into the negative aspect of him. Like I said in all these videos, I'm not going over scandals, you guys, or like big mistakes and issues. If you wanna look those up, they are so easy to find on YouTube and on Google. You just have to type in their name and put scandal and stuff will pop up. So the positive thing is that a lot of interviews that I have watched with him in them and him just going over the history of his political party and what he has achieved and what he has done, because not everything is perfect, and he has made a lot of mistakes and I guess voted for some shitty things to be done in Germany. He has generally mostly apologized, and he openly talks about the mistakes that he's made, and that's something that I really think takes a lot of character, and it makes you, I don't know, a more sympathetic person when you can admit to your faults, you can admit to your mistakes, and you could say, hey, what I did was really crappy. The con that I have, though, goes into the same point, and it's that you have been in the majority of German politics, meaning most of the stuff that you have voted for or that you have been pro have happened in Germany. And some of those things have been very detrimental to certain groups of people here. And also, a lot of the promises and guarantees that you have made, you have not pulled pulled through. It would be different if the party was only 1%, 5% to get into the Bundestag, and that little tiny percent was saying stuff or making promises, but you've been part of a huge majority and you haven't been able to, I guess, keep those promises. And so I think to myself also, it's like, yes, you've done amazing stuff in the past, but you've been doing this for decades now, and don't you think it's time to give it up or to let someone else do it? So yeah, the SPD, aus Respekt für deine Zukunft, which is respect for your future, or out of respect for your future. And they get an A+ for their Wahlprogramm in the length of it. It was 66 pages. Red, black, and white is an amazing color scheme. It was easy to read, organized perfectly. The words still a little, you know, complex for not a non-German native, but I do have to say just how it was organized and written was A+, so up there. So they started off their political program saying that they wanted to be climate neutral latest of 2045. You guys know my stance on this. I think it's too late, but that's just me. They want to use renewable energy sources, and they want to financially balloon. What does balloon mean? I even wrote balloon. Why would I do this to myself? Climate-friendly businesses. Respect was a very big word used in their political campaigns, so they want to push for respect. And I think that's something very important to include. And this is one big point that I've always talked about German society, that no matter what, I can always say, even though you guys got mad at me when I talked about the lady with the hose and I said that Germans were in a bad mood because of the crisis and all that good stuff. But one thing I do love about Germans, aside from that one evil woman, is that they have a lot of respect for one another, other people, other cultures, majority of the time. But even in heated situations, you know, I can be a hothead, and when I'm confronted with German people in a tricky situation, a friction situation, German people are still very respectful and cool. And this is also coming from an American, though, where I've seen people pull out guns because they get mad that someone skipped them at a McDonald's drive-thru line. So maybe it's just easy for me to find respect here. And maybe other countries or nations feel like Germans are very hot-headed. But for me, that's something that I feel fits very perfectly with German society. But yeah, going off of that rant, they want to stray away from discrimination in all forms. So yeah, going back to the climate point, you guys, I just want to know where they get the 2045 number. Is it the Paris Agreement? Is it some weird ritual that they came up with in the Bundestag or the Reichstag Keller? I don't know if they were sitting there and they had to like cut knives on their hands and put the blood there and do a sacrificial lamb or something to come up with this 2045 number. I don't know where they're getting it from. I'm just trying to think, what would make you literally sit down and come up with a number that is 20 plus years away to attain a goal that is necessary for today? I'm just trying to figure it out. But something that I did like for them is that they said they wanted to be a little bit more specific, and they want to, by 2030, that it would be 65%, and 2040, 88%. So I feel like that's better, but they also wanted it to be abhängig. What is abhängig in English? On how fast all of this can happen. And that's also with, I mean, atomic energy, nuclear energy. They said that's done. They're already going to step out of that. They don't want to be part of it anymore. And they also said regarding coal, as fast as they are getting more renewable energy sources is the rate that they will be stopping coal. That's smart in some way, shape, or form, because you need energy at the end of the day. You can't just say we're not using coal anymore if you don't have any other energy harvested or able to be harvested. It's just like a sexy, plump, glistening red apple at the top of the tree. You just gotta find out how to get up there. And I think that's where Germany is right now. There are so many awesome ideas that a lot of parties have put out. So I just like that they put a little bit more, I guess, detail regarding this. They said for transportation, they wanted to make mobility accessible for everyone. And an interesting point that I liked was that they wanted to make stuff barrier-free. I think it's barrier-free in English, barrier-free. And so what that means is that, let's say you can't walk up steps, you have an escalator. Let's say that you can't go up an escalator because you're in a wheelchair, you have an elevator. And so they said they want to focus on making Germany more disability, I guess, friendly. And you also have to keep in mind, a lot of people tend to forget that there are disabled people that work. Some people just associate disability with people that can't work or people that can't do this. And there are a lot of people that are disabled that still want to live a everyday normal life like everyone else. Just because they have a disability, that should not prevent them from being able to do that. It's more so to be able to go to work, to be able to be social, to be able to get outside and transport yourself. Because if you aren't able to do those things, it puts you at a disadvantage. And we are trying to avoid that for every single person, not just disabled people, every single human being, or I should say every person living in Germany. For public transportation, they said they wanted to try out different models. One of the models they listed was a 365 euro ticket. I can jump on that train. See what I did there? No, but seriously, 365 a year for public transportation seems plausible. So if it is affordable, if it is efficient, I think that a public transportation ticket would be a good idea. And it would also motivate people to go on trains, public transportation more. And that is the end goal for a lot of parties, is to get less people or more people out of cars and onto the trains. Another point that they brought up, which I thought was interesting, a lot of parties brought this up as well. I think the CDU explicitly brought this up too. They want to make inland like train trips more attractive in Germany and Europe. And for me, I don't know why you would personally want to take a freaking plane from Munich to, let's say, Berlin. Usually it takes you like 1 hour to get to the airport. It takes 1 hour to get through security, check-in, all that good stuff. Then you fly for 1 hour and then you get your baggage at the baggage claim at the destination airport. And from there you have to drive or take another train or a bus to your destination. That's another hour. So then you're at 4 hours travel time, when you can literally hop on a train from Hauptbahnhof in München and go to Berlin in 4 hours. And I think it's like 3 hours and 59 minutes, like the fast train. So then I'm just thinking to myself, why would you fly? They said the Deutsche Bahn should continue to be state-owned. Y'all know how I feel about that. Whatever, I think it's fine. I think state-owned is fine, but I really do think that they need to handle the train situation a little better. I don't think how the Deutsche Bahn runs things is amazing. There's too many strikes, trains not coming, they're too late. I just don't understand how they want to make it more attractive if they're not going to fix like the main issue, which is Deutsche Bahn. They want to digitalize schools. They want all kids to have access to a terminal. I'm assuming a computer or a laptop or some sort of like thing, like an iPad or something maybe, with internet. They want internet access to be affordable, and they want access to the internet to be easy for everyone. They said they are pro-European cloud infrastructure, which I don't know what that means. I don't know nothing about the cloud, y'all. I'm assuming they mean that they want the cloud to be European, only European accessible. Like, I don't know what that means, what they're trying to say with that, where all the data goes to. I thought that the clouds were just like this imaginary space that stuff went to and it was saved there. I have no idea how technology works, and I will never claim to have an Ahnung about these types of things. They want to go back to being pharmacists of the world, and they want to focus a little bit more on that because it's very lucrative, of course. And also they use Corona-Zeit as a way to say that, hey, we have been dependent on other countries, other drug manufacturers. Why should we be when we have created amazing medical technology and drugs? Why are we depending on other places? And when you watch my CDU video, which hopefully it'll either go up tomorrow or the next day, you will know how I feel about this. But yes, I do think, you know, go in your strengths, focus on that, and make that your star quality. You want to be the master of one trade and not the jack of all. But one of the funniest things that they included in this BAD program, which I cannot believe that they did, it made me laugh, it made Mike laugh, was that the health research, the health data, the health science, the health education, the health practical settings are all made by old white men, and they want to change that. And I'm just thinking to myself, who is your Kanzlerkandidat? What do you mean you want to change this? You're literally putting someone else that is an old white man up there. There's nothing against old white men. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, why would you put this in your political program? They included a little about health, but they didn't really include a lot of numbers, plans, and percentages that I wish they would have, but they just said that things needed to be changed. They wanted to digitalize stuff, and they wanted to lower the wages of Pflege people in those specific jobs. Not lower the wages. Wait, that sounds wrong. I think lower the, like, the burden those people have. They want to make their wages more attractive. They said that specific companies need to make certain contributions to the community, society, the government, Facebook, Google. They were talking about digital companies, and I'm 1,000 for this, you guys. I said, I don't know if it was in the FDP or in the Grunet, I did explicitly say this, you need to go after these people. Why are we not going after these people? There needs to be a target on their back. Well, you know what? One day I'm gonna get censored by Facebook, by YouTube, by Amazon, by Tesla, by all these people. They're like, damn girl, leave us alone, shut up. I'm glad that they included this. They are the only party, I believe, like I said, I could have overseen it, but they were the only party that explicitly included the names of the companies that they want to go after. They want to have a secure and stable finance market in order to finance the change into a digital and sustainable society. And they also said that it needs to be regulated and surveillance, which I don't know if surveillance is the right word, looked over to make sure there's no discrepancies. And I feel like this is the opposite of what the FDP wants. The FDP wants a little bit of freedom, you know, not so much scrutiny from the government, not so much like magnifying glasses regarding finances, but the SPD really wants to make sure that money is going where it's supposed to. There are no loose ends, no money's being funneled here or there. That's good. They also said that a lot of jobs are going through a change due to digitalization, or just that they're not popular anymore, or just with how the times are changing, and that those jobs will need to be revamped to keep up with the times, or they're going to die out. And so in order to fill the void that will be there, they need to focus on secondary or further education. They said they want to make sure there's full health insurance coverage and the prices will gradually increase over time. Like I said, if this is at the same rate that the incomes are increasing, I don't mind this. But if the incomes aren't increasing at the same rate that the health insurance rates are increasing, then it seems a little unfair. They said culture is vital, it's life or death, and that it's a catalyst for debate. And I totally agree with this. The only thing that I think, because they said it's under threat, is that the idea of culture has shifted totally from 100 years ago. What used to be considered culture back then is no longer considered culture now. Or maybe it is, but it's just not as popular. But they did include money, and they did say they wanted to go over different models to strengthen revenue regarding culture. And they said that educated and motivated police officers are important for security in Germany. I 1000% agree with this. I also think that an educated and motivated society equates to more security, like safety in Germany, not just the police. The police are doing a job, and you would hope that everyone around them is doing the same thing or has the same moral compass and background as they do. So you have to make sure that people are able to respect police officers. You're hoping that police officers respect people, and you also want to make sure that everyone is some way on the same level of education, and I don't know, just like I said, respect for one another. And I think when you have those things in there, you're gonna have low crime or very minimal crime. They said that animals should not be harmed for Germany's economic interest, but they did not really list too many things that went into not harming animals. They included things like they would limit space or make a limit to how many animals could be in a certain space. They included less antibiotic use, which I don't think is for the animals. It's more so for like people. Maybe I'm wrong. And that there will be more rules and laws regarding animal welfare. But the problem I've seen with this is that there are already rules and laws regarding animal welfare. And a lot of companies, they just break those rules and they don't care about the laws. And either the government turns a blind eye or finds them, but doesn't really do anything to help the welfare of the animals. And so we're already slaughtering animals. We could at least make their life a little bit more enjoyable than keeping them in tiny ass cages and transporting them for 10 hours in tiny ass hot ass vehicles. I mean, so it's important, but are you really going to pull through with these rules and these laws that you want to put in? Are you really going to say, hey, you're not allowed to do that, and go in, observe, and make sure it's not happening? Or are you just going to tell companies they owe you a fine? They're still going to pay you a fine. They make a lot of money and they don't care about the animals' lives and how happy they are and how comfortable they are. And they said no genetically modified plants. They said NATO is staying. They want to continue building a relationship with the United States, which is important. You know, I'm here, so very important for me. They said they want to work with Russia in certain areas and that working with Russia is in Germany's best interest and Europe's best interest. And I was like, take what you want from that. And they talked about China and they talked about the prejudice, discrimination, forced slave labor, genocide, whatever horrible things, atrocious things that happen over there regarding the, I think it's the Uyghur. But I do think this is important, especially when you're wanting to work with a country, because you technically can't work with a country that has stuff like this happening, you know, very openly there. And I just think this is a good idea when you're talking about working with a country, being in cahoots with another country, another nation, another government that's allowing these things to happen or that is putting these people through this. You need to make a clear statement where you stand in this. So moving forward, I would like to know what happens if Germany's going to keep working with China, or if they want to build a relationship with China, what they're going to do for that particular issue, because not many people talk about it. Like I said, I didn't see it. I don't think I saw it in any other political party's program, so it's not on many people's radar. That was it. That was the SPD. You can let me know what you think about them. Other than that, I'm going. Oh, if you like social democracy, the SPD might be for you. I would recommend you check out their Wahlprogramm. Thank you so much for watching, you guys. Bye.